Let me say some serious words now, warning in advance that I can't possibly cover every subject without filibustering, and I know you don't want that. So I'll touch on just a few and hopefully have a lively discussion in your questions and comments. And I tell you right now, so you can prepare, when I was in office going around, I used to just warn audiences to just ask questions, not give speeches in the guise of question. But since I'm not running for anything, I don't even want to give a speech. Feel free to do so, you can start preparing it now. A visitor from Mars who would come to this world and spent the last year watching television in the United States, particularly the cable television news, would likely conclude that the world is falling apart, the world is more dangerous than ever, and the United States is in a state of terminal decline at home and in retreat abroad. I disagree on all counts, and I'd like to tell you why. Fear of the future and lament about the current state of our society or civilization in general are as old as human civilization. Everyone here, or at least almost everyone, will remember 1968. The Vietnam War was raging. President Johnson withdrew, Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy were assassinated, riots ripped through many American cities. There may be a few of you here, and I think there are, who remember the United States in the 1930s, during the time of the Great Depression, when fear of the future and lament for a lost past were widespread in our country. Or you can go all the way back to 500 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. The Greek city-states were going through a long, slow transition from dictatorship to oligarchy to a rudimentary form of democracy. And at every stage of that transition, which lasted a couple of centuries, people lamented the future and yearned the past. Here's a quote written in 550 BC. Gone is faith. No one any longer reveres God. The generation of religious men is no more. Traditional values have been lost. That ancient author was a member of a family of oligarchs which controlled a Greek city-state. And he was deeply troubled by the notion that ordinary citizens would be able to share in the governance of their society in a very rudimentary form of democracy. To him, that was a radical departure from past tradition and was seen as a danger to the future of the entire society. Now, the world was dangerous then. It always has been. And it's dangerous now. But by some important measures, this world is actually much safer than it has been in any recent century. In the 20th century, not counting all of the other wars in just the two world wars, not counting Vietnam or Korea or any other of the countless wars, in just the two world wars, 78 million people died. In a world in which the population was a third of what it is today in the world. Each death in conflict is a tragedy, but today the deaths are in the dozens or the scores, occasionally in the hundreds. In the 20th century of those great conflicts, deaths were in the thousands and the tens of thousands. That could happen again if another world war erupts. But that is not likely at any time in the foreseeable future because of the economic strength and the military dominance and the leadership of the United States. So while local and regional conflicts will continue and will have devastating impacts on those directly involved, no worldwide war is likely simply because there is no conceivable one nation or grouping of nations that is likely to be able to challenge the United States in such a conflict. In the coming decades, and I take that to be from now till about mid-century, it will become increasingly clear that the long period of relative stability that followed the Second World War has come to an end. What we now regard as extraordinary political upheaval in the Middle East will become the norm for many years to come. In Asia and Africa, rapid population growth will result in rising demand on natural resources and growing pressures on governments to provide jobs, opportunity, and hope. Many factors affect population growth, among them the status of women. Where women are independent and empowered, populations tend to stabilize unless increased directly by large-scale immigration. Where women are not independent and empowered, growth rates tend to rise. And across much of Africa, North Africa, and much of the Middle East and other parts of Asia, women are not fully independent and empowered. And sadly, in the most vulnerable areas, all of these pressures will be greatly aggravated by very poor governance and widespread corruption. Consider just a few facts about population. It took 1,800 years following the birth of Christ for the world's population to reach 1 billion. The most recent billion, the seventh, was added in 13 years. Of the 7.5 billion people living in the world today, 1 in 5 is Muslim, about 1.5 billion. By 2060, the population will be edging close to 10 billion, and 1 in 3 will be Muslim. That's about 3.5 billion. Keep that in perspective, that was the total population of the world as recently as 1970. As we all know, there are many internal conflicts within Islam, some of which overlap, some intersect, some of which are contradictory. Some date from the colonial period, some date from the immediate aftermath of World War I, some go all the way back to the 7th century, and the political competition to succeed the Prophet Muhammad, which led to the initial division between Sunni and Shia. It was not a religious struggle. It was a political struggle for political power. Now that division between Sunni and Shia has been marked by alternating periods of violent expansion and remission over the past 1,400 years. It is now intense and expanding. And we see it manifested in the challenges the long-established balances of power in Iraq and Syria, now Yemen, that have opened up that divide with catastrophic consequences for the people of those countries. There are, within Islam, as in all other parts of the world and in all other religions, complicating factors beyond religion. The naked drive for political power has, throughout human history, often been disguised as a religious endeavor. And so have the actions of many who, in normal circumstances, would be seen as purely criminal. They use accepted values like religion and patriotism to justify violent and illegal acts. And finally, there is everywhere an economic factor. I recall very clearly my first day in Northern Ireland. I was taken to Belfast, capital and largest city, where there remains today an ugly high wall separating the Catholic and Protestant communities. It's 30 feet high, topped in places with barbed wire. It goes right through the middle of the city, right across streets, and in some cases, right through buildings. In the morning, I met on their side of the wall with a group of Catholics. In the afternoon, on their side of the wall with a group of Protestants. To my surprise, the messages were similar. And they were best illustrated by a Protestant minister who rose in the late afternoon, one of the most powerful orators, compelling speakers I've ever heard, He brought with him two large maps, and he tacked the first one up on the wall. It was titled Unemployment in the Urban Areas of Northern Ireland. And then he took the second one and he laid it over the first one. It was titled Violence in the Urban Areas of Northern Ireland. And you will not be surprised to hear that the two fit like a hand in a glove. He made the point that it is the lack of opportunity, the lack of jobs, and most of all, the lack of hope that was a huge driving factor in the conflict, that while it did have religious, territorial, and national identity as factors, economics was a major factor, and that remains true today. Now, I believe that over the next few decades, the United States will continue to play a central role in world affairs. I believe that our economy is now entering a period of sustained economic expansion. And I believe that as far into the future as human beings can see, the United States will be the dominant world power. Power is, of course, relative. So you have to look at potential competitors. Half of the Russian government's revenues come from direct taxes on oil and gas. The break-even point for the Russian government's national budget requires oil at $110 a barrel. There is no expert, whom I am aware, government or private, who expects oil to be at that level for any sustained period in the near future. And so Russia faces a severe financial crisis, although it is currently being mitigated somewhat by the decline in the value of the ruble. In addition, Russia's population continues to decline. Despite heroic measures by the Russian government to arrest the decline, and more importantly, the composition of the population changes dramatically. Muslims now represent 20% of the Russian population, are growing very rapidly, while the Slavic population declines steeply. When he first took office, President Putin said that he was concerned that for the first time in centuries, Russia faced the possibility, in his words, of slipping into the second or third rank of nations in the world. His concern was justified. He may succeed in reestablishing dominance in small parts of adjacent territories, but it will be a costly and fleeting victory, and neither he nor any future Russian leader will be able to recreate the Soviet Empire. Russia will remain important because it has a huge arsenal of nuclear weapons, and because it has substantial petroleum resources. But it will be in the second or third echelon of nations by the middle of this century. In contrast, China and India will grow in economic strength and therefore in influence, but they too face daunting problems. President Xi has acquired more personal power than any Chinese leader since Mao. Xi plainly regards the continued centralization of power within the Communist Party as essential to what he says is the needed transformation of the country and continued strong economic growth, which is the essential factor in the continuing authority of the Chinese government. And yet, despite its enormous capacity and potential, China faces major obstacles. The rule of law and an independent judiciary, so critical to both individual freedom and to business investment, have not been firmly established. Corruption remains a major issue, one that the new president is going to extraordinary lengths to try to deal with, but history tells us that requires a fundamental shift in culture over a long period of time to overcome. The demand for energy continues to rise, fueling more pollution, more protests, which in Chinese history is a contributing factor to destabilization. The Chinese are an energetic and a talented people, but even with their many strengths, the country faces a long uphill road to becoming the world's dominant power. India already is the world's largest democracy. It soon will become the largest country in population as well. By the middle of this century, there will be 1.8 billion Indians, while the Chinese population will remain stable at the current 1.3 billion. But India, too, faces staggering problems, a large and slow-moving bureaucracy, widespread corruption, a huge number of undereducated and unskilled rural residents, most of whom live in poverty and lack opportunity, the continued threat of internal religious strife. You have to keep in mind that although it is a majority Hindu nation, India has the second largest Muslim population of any country in the world. India is and will be important precisely because it will be the world's largest country and the world's largest democracy. But it is highly unlikely to become a dominant world power. Now, of course, we in the United States face many challenges, and I'll mention just a few in the interest of time. First, we must never lose sight of the fact that military power and world influence are grounded in economic strength at home. We must somehow find a way to get our political and our financial houses in order. We all know it's an urgent need. That would take a whole separate speech, and I'll be glad to come back next year and give that one. But I do want to mention one issue that I know your organization is focused on and that I think is especially critical. And it is what I call the corruption of American politics. I don't mean corruption in the traditional sense of someone giving a congressman a suitcase full of cash to vote for or against a particular bill. Fortunately, that's very rare in our society. What I'm talking about is that the trust of the American people in their elected officials, so essential to a functioning and stable democracy, has been severed. I want to ask you a question I've asked audiences all over America. Who here believes that the elected members of Congress are more responsive to their constituents than they are to their donors? I've asked that question for 5 years of audiences all over America, and in all that time, one woman raised her hand. It was a year ago in Washington, and after the event, I went up to her, I said, I won't embarrass you, I didn't say anything in front of the crowd, but you're the only person in America who's ever raised your hand, so I feel compelled to ask you why. She said, it's very simple, my husband's a member of Congress. There isn't anybody in this country who believes that our political leaders are responsive to their constituents ahead of their donors. Now, the Supreme Court did not create the problem. Money has always played a role in our politics. But the court's decision in the Citizens United case has made the problem infinitely worse. It was, in my opinion, one of the worst decisions ever made by any Supreme Court in American history. And let me quote you a couple of sentences from that decision. First, quote, independent expenditures, including those made by corporations, do not give rise to corruption or to the appearance of corruption. Does anybody here agree with that? Let me read you another quote from it. The appearance of influence or of access will not cause the electorate to lose faith in our democracy. Does anybody here believe that? As those quotes make clear, the Citizens United case, signed by 5 Supreme Court justices, is based on a fantasy that is completely divorced from the reality of American politics. And the result has been a spectacular increase in the amount of money pouring into our political process, accompanied by a dangerous decline in the disclosure of the sources of that money. So we now have the worst of both. Much more money, much less transparency. Now, there are many changes we could discuss about how to deal with that. I'm not a political scientist. I don't know them all. One of them is redistricting. But my own view is that one crucial element must be the reform of our system for financing political campaigns. It simply will not end until there is some reasonable restraint on the amount of money going into politics and an increase in the disclosure of the sources of that money. I'll go on to another subject. Secondly, we Americans will face many challenges in the coming decades, and in confronting those, we must remain true to our principles. Our democratic ideals distinguished our country from the very beginning, and they have always appealed to people all over the world. Our economic strength and military power are necessary and important, but our ideals have been and remain to this day the primary basis of American influence in the world. The displeasure with Americans, about which we hear so much in our media, is not based on our ideals. It is based on the perception that our actions and our ideals are at variance. That's the challenge that we face, closing that gap. Our ideals aren't easily summarized, but surely they include the sovereignty of the people, the primacy, the highest priority of individual liberty, an independent judiciary, the rule of law applied equally to all, especially and including to the government itself, and opportunity for every member of society. No American should ever forget that this was a great country long before it was a great military or economic power. This was a great country on the day that the Constitution was adopted following the Declaration of Independence a decade earlier, which set forth these principles. We recognize that all human beings and all human societies, including our own, are imperfect. We are not always right. We have made tragic mistakes, and we can never be perfectly consistent, much as we would like to be. Yet we can, and we must work harder and better as a society and as individuals to at least come closer to living up to our ideals. In the turbulence of this century, particularly in the areas that I described earlier of instability, the United States will often be asked to intervene militarily in other lands to resolve complex disputes. I want to pause to tell a story about a year ago. I was in London speaking to an organization similar to this, a British think tank. And in the question and answer period, a man got up and scathingly denounced President Obama for not militarily intervening in Syria to insert an American military force that would separate the combatants and keep the peace. And he said, in very strong and emotional terms, I think at that time the number dead was 70,000. President Obama and you, Senator Mitchell, have the blood of 70,000 dead people on your hands. I said to him, just that morning, by a complete coincidence, I read an article in the Financial Times that in the Congo, in the last several years of fighting, 2.5 million people had died. And I asked him, why aren't you complaining about the United States not intervening in the Congo, where 2.5 million people have been killed? And before he could answer, an African man jumped up and said, Senator, you're wrong. I said, how am I wrong? He said, it's not 2.5 million, it's 5.5 million. And sure enough, just a few months later, the CIA declassified a report which estimated the number of deaths in the Congo at 5.5 million. Why aren't people complaining about the United States not sending a military force into the Congo to
separate the combatants and to save lives. And Sudan, and Libya, and Yemen, and so many other places around the world. We're going to be asked over and over and over again, because of our status as the dominant power, to intervene militarily in other lands to resolve complex and often ancient disputes. We will appropriately respond to some, but among the greatest challenges American presence will have in the next several decades will be making that crucial judgment of when it is appropriate and when it is not. And there's a lot of criticism of President Obama today, but I'll tell you, American presidents had better act with restraint, or we will find ourselves with armies in every part of the globe trying to resolve complex disputes. And the notion that an American military force can enter a conflict and separate the parties is a fantasy, because the American force will immediately become the target of previously warring combatants. We have to be smarter, and we have to figure out ways to do it other than military force, although, as I said, there will be some occasions when force is necessary. And we have to rid ourselves of the notion that every problem in the world is an American problem. When I travel in Asia, depending on where I am, I tell two stories to make the point. The first one is a Pakistani official wakes up one morning in Karachi. He goes into the bathroom to take a shower. He turns the faucet. There's no hot water. Ah, he says, Obama, the CIA, again. We are not responsible for hot water in Karachi. We have to get it out of our heads. We will be asked because of our status as dominant power. In my two tours of duty in the Middle East, I traveled throughout the region, throughout Africa, and much of Europe, and I met with more than 24 heads of state. And very, very frequently, the discussion turned to American foreign policy. And they're always quick to point out all of the mistakes that we made, because they follow American politics, and they know there's an echo chamber here. If someone abroad criticizes a Republican president, the Democrats echo it, and vice versa, then. So I used to ask them all, will you tell me what you think a good American foreign policy would be? And you will not be surprised to know that every single one of them, without exception, described a policy that was favorable to their countries. Societies, like individuals, act out of self-interest. And we have to act out of our self-interest. And our self-interest dictates that while we be prepared to use force where necessary and appropriate, we cannot be indiscriminate about it, and we can't fight every war, we can't resolve every dispute, and we can't fight others' battles everywhere in the world. We have to be careful, we have to be prudent. Now last, I want to say a word about opportunity for all here at home. This is important. I confess a personal stake in this. Before I entered the Senate, I had the privilege of serving as a federal district court judge in Maine. And in that position, I had great power. The only job I've ever had where I had any real power, believe me, the Senate certainly has zero power. But when I was a federal judge, every order I ever issued was followed, and I loved that part of the job. But what I most enjoyed is when I presided over naturalization ceremonies. They're citizenship ceremonies, a group of people who come from every part of the world, gathered before me in a federal courtroom in either Portland or Bangor, Maine, and I administered to them the oath of allegiance to the United States, and by the power vested in me under our Constitution, I made them Americans. It was always a highly emotional ceremony for me, because my mother was an immigrant. She could not read or write English. She spent 50 years working the night shift in textile mills. My father was the orphan son of immigrants. He had no education. He was raised in an orphanage, and he worked as a janitor at a local school. But because of their efforts, and more importantly, because of the openness of American society. I had many helping hands, was able to get an education, and became the majority leader of the United States Senate. After every one of these citizenship ceremonies, I invited each of the new Americans to come into my office and to talk to me personally, individually or in family groups. I asked them how they came, why they came. I asked them to tell me about their dreams and their fears. They were all inspirational. They were different, but there were common themes. And they were best summarized by a young Asian man who, when I asked him why he came, replied in very slow and halting English and said, "I came here because in America, everybody has a chance." Think about the fact a young man who could barely speak English, who had been in America for less than 10 minutes, was able to sum up the meaning of our country in a single sentence. America is freedom and opportunity. This is a society in which no one should be guaranteed success, but every single one should have a fair chance to succeed. From the experience of daily life, we know that equal opportunity for all in America today remains an aspiration, not a reality. And our task as Americans must be to do the best we can to make it a reality for as many of our young people as possible. Our goal should be a society which encourages striving, which celebrates success, honors those who do well, is conducive to innovation, and enables us to benefit from the talent and energy of every American. That means that each child in our society should have good care, early development, good education to enable them to rise as high and as far as their talent, their willingness to work, their willingness to take risks will carry them. I think our best years lie ahead. It lies in a world of increasing trade, greater communication, more global connection, all of which makes isolationism totally obsolete. We can't withdraw from the Middle East or from North Africa or from Asia without risking that the problems there will find their ways here. We can't abandon our role as a world leader. We must provide leadership, and we must do so in a manner that is both consistent with our history and with our ideals. And I believe that we can, and we will, as we have done so often in the past. Thank you all for having me. I'll be glad now to take your questions.
Very early on in your remarks, you talked about the defense of America is in its strength, and it would be very hard for any consortium of countries to come against us. My question is, what about the one guy who gets a hold of a bad bomb and can and has whatever delivery service can create that kind of chaos?
It is a risk which grows over time. One of the reasons that I feel very strongly that Iran must not get a nuclear weapon is because I believe that it would undermine the nuclear non-proliferation regime, which has quite successfully restrained the dissemination of such weapons over the past 60 years. There are now many countries in the world who either have or could quickly acquire the capacity to make nuclear weapons, but who have voluntarily refrained from doing so in reliance upon the United States and the non-proliferation